things are unclear, and I don't know the reason why you brought me here. But just because you love me the way that you do, I'm gonna walk through the valley if you want me to. When I took my first step, and I'm clinging to the promise, you're not through with me yet. So if all of these trials bring me closer to you, then I will walk through the fire if you want me to. Against me, and I'm all by myself, and I can't hear you answer my cries for help. I'll remember the suffering your love put you through, and I will go through the valley if you.
Amen. Thank you so much, Erica. Appreciate that so very, very much. Most of you know that I've just returned from a mission to Ghana, West Africa, where our church, for those of you that are a little newer or maybe guests, our church has a partnership, a church planting partnership with Pastor Emmanuel Mustafa there, who jointly, along with our church, began there the West Africa Global Mission Center. And it was a marvelous, although exhausting, mission trip. But last Sunday, I had the privilege of preaching, and I think I was about 7 hours ahead of your service time, but I had the privilege of preaching in the Sonny Myers Baptist Church of Northeast Ghana, which is named in the honor of Brother Cliff Myers' father. And show you just a little excerpt of our time together.
And when he had made everything else in the universe, he made a man and a woman in his own image.
And I wish I had time to preach that whole sermon to you this morning, but for another day. But Pastor Moose and I have worked together for a while, trying to encourage the pastors of West Africa to be more engaged in evangelism of their own areas and of all of West Africa and beyond, because of the vast, vast numbers of people there who know little or nothing of Christ and who are lost because they've not come to put their trust in Jesus as their own Savior and Lord. In the past several years, God has opened a number of opportunities for us that we've been blessed to participate in trying to take the message of the Great Commission in Acts 1:8 to pastors. And so we've been invited to teach the Acts 1:8 mandate and strategy in several of the Baptist pastors' conventions in Ghana and in Togo and in Burkina Faso. But although that was well received, Moose and I both lamented at the end of those that there was just no opportunity to do any hands-on training, taking pastors into the field and let them actually get to participate in the sharing of the gospel and see how that can lead to the planting of churches. And so after the last one, he and I just determined that we were going to change the way we were sharing the message in these conferences, and we're going to find a way to be able to train pastors in the field. And so this year, we assembled some of Moose's key leaders out of the region around Yindi, and then some newer pastors as well, and taught on several different levels. But ultimately, what we were able to do, of course, in our sessions, the first thing we did was just begin with worship. You know, our African brothers and sisters have a passionate way of worshiping, which is marvelous to be able to participate in and to join with. But after we worshiped, and we did have plenty of class time to look at what the Scripture says about the Great Commission and about God's strategy of how we're to make disciples of the nations, but we're to do so by starting in our own area and then to move out in the areas around us and ultimately to people all over the earth. But this time, we took them to the field. And we had a group, all of them together, of about 55 pastors and leaders, and we divided them into four groups, and we went four different directions, and each group went to villages where the gospel of Jesus Christ had never been proclaimed. And, of course, we had to gain the permission of the village chief to be able to talk to the people of the village. But having gained that, then the people assembled and we were able to begin sharing the message of the Scripture and the story of the gospel.
One day, when the time was just right, the Savior came to the world. His name was Jesus.
We started with the story of creation, how the one true and living God began all that there is and went to declare the good news that God's Son Jesus had come into our world, that he had gone to a cross to pay the penalty for our sin. And then we had the wonderful privilege of offering to them the promises of the gospel, that they could receive forgiveness of sin and the gift of eternal life if they would simply trust in Jesus as the Lord, as the master of their lives, and as their Savior. And we were very blessed to see a very large percentage of the people in each of the villages that we were in accept that invitation and put their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. But not only did we go to the villages, we did something that we've never done before. Over the course of the training, we trained about 55, 56 pastors and leaders in using the Evangicube and how to use that person to person or house to house. And then we went out together, not far from those of you that have been as a part of our missions know where Yindi is, not very far from the Dittany Baptist Church, just up the street. We went to some neighborhoods each side of the highway that are predominantly Muslim neighborhoods. Now, I will tell you, as much as I have gone house to house sharing the gospel, this was
the first opportunity I ever had to go to neighborhoods that were almost exclusively Muslim. But we took the pastors with us, divided up into groups of about three or four people, going to different areas of the neighborhood and went house to house. And do you know, in these places, we were not refused conversation a single time. Everyone welcomed us, was glad to talk with us. Their homes are mud huts with straw thatch roofs, but they're always built, or almost always built, in a circle so that you enter a gateway, and then they all surround an open courtyard where all of the cooking and a lot of the other work is done. But they received us into the courtyard of their home, and there they met with us. And even those that were very staunchly Muslim and having listened to us said, "No, I'm Muslim. I'm not going to trust in Christ." Nevertheless, were very kind in their reception to us. But in just 3 hours of us sharing the gospel house to house in this Muslim neighborhood, we got to see 57 people pray to receive Christ as Lord and Savior. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I tell you, I also got to see the new home of Northeastern Christian Academy that Brother Moose is building, and which we have a team, a construction team, that is going to be going to work with Pastor Moose in June to work on this building. And as you can see, those of you planning to join that, there's still a little bit to be done. So you will not be bored when you go to participate in that. Folks, I am incredibly grateful to the Lord that He has opened the door for our church to be a part of what God is doing in West Africa, a part of bringing some of the many, some of that great multitude of lost people, bringing them to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and to know Him and live with Him for all eternity. And we can continue to be a part of that partnership by our giving, by our praying, by our going. You know, sharing this partnership with God is one of the perks of being a good manager, of being a good steward. We have, the past several Sunday mornings that I was with you, been looking at principles from God's Word that begin in the book of Genesis, but which do not end there. And the principles we have seen thus far, beginning in Genesis and carried through into the New Testament, are first that God is the owner of everything, that God made it all, and therefore God owns it all. But He made us. He made man and woman not only in His image, but He made us in His image so that we might be managers of everything that He made. Imagine that. We have been created for the purpose of being able to take care of all the things that God has made, not only in this world, but in this universe. And then we have seen the principle that God greatly blesses His faithful managers. That if we'll just do what God created us to do, and we will be good managers, we will be good stewards of the things He has entrusted to our care, that He will greatly bless us in the doing of it. Now, two Sundays ago, I shared with you, particularly from God's Word, what the perks were for being a faithful manager. But today, I want to show you the other side of the coin. Now, we're going to look this morning at the pitfalls of being a manager. Now, you may be thinking right now, "Well, Brother Mike, I know how to avoid the pitfalls of being one of God's managers. I just won't." You know, I won't apply for that job. I'll just not be one of God's managers. I will not agree to be in management. Well, my friend, that's kind of like saying, well, I refuse to be a human because of the possible pitfalls of being a part of humanity. Well, that's silliness. I mean, we are human because God made us human. But likewise, each of us are managers. We are stewards, not because we applied for the job, not even because we necessarily wanted the job. It's just a part of the way that God made us. God made us to be His managers. He made us to be His caretakers, and we are. Folks, even lost people, folks before they come to Christ, or folks that never come to Christ, are still managers. They're still stewards of the things of the earth that God has made and put into their charge. God made Adam and Eve to be His managers, stewards of the earth, and partners with God. And you know, for a while, Adam and Eve were both faithful managers. They were good stewards, taking care of all that God had entrusted to their care, obeying Him as the owner, following Him as the boss, doing what He wanted to do with the things that He had created. This they did for a while. Now, Bible students vary in their estimate of how long that while was. You know, how long were Adam and Eve faithful managers? How long were they good stewards? Well, some think a few weeks. Some think a few months. Some even think maybe a few years. However long it was, there's no doubt that there came a day for Adam and Eve when they quit doing what the owner, they quit doing what the boss told them to do. And they chose to do instead what they wanted to do. Now, there is a lot, I mean, there is a ton to be learned about their choice. And we're going to look more at that in greater detail in a few weeks. But today, I want us to consider their choice in light of their position as managers, in light of God having put them in management to take care of all of this marvelous creation that He had made. What happened when they made this choice? So would you keep that perspective in mind as we read what happened from the Word of God? Stand with me as we read just three verses. Genesis chapter 2, verses 16 and 17, followed by Genesis 3:6. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, "Of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you will surely die." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took its fruit and ate, and also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. You may be seated. We could spend all morning trying to analyze the motives of both Eve and Adam as to why, when they had been faithfully walking with God since the day of their creation, why, after enjoying all the benefits and the privileges of being God's obedient managers, why in the world would they now abandon all that they had been given in order to exercise their choice contrary to God's commands? I mentioned we will certainly come back to this passage and examine this important question another day. But for our purposes today, actually, the reason why they disobeyed God, the reason why they chose their desire over the desire of God, is not what matters. The fact is, they chose to disobey. They did not want to do the one thing that a good manager, that a faithful steward must always do. And that is what the boss wants, what the owner wants. And they refused to do it. And thus began the fall of man. His and her fall into sin, which is disobedience of God. Their joint fall out of both relationship with God and fellowship with God. And thus began the end of a period of faithful stewardship as the appointed managers of God in the garden. Adam and Eve were the first ones to do this. But sadly, they were far from the last. 3,600 years after Adam and Eve made this choice, God's prophet Malachi addressed a group of people who were very confident of their relationship with God, because they were not only a part of God's chosen people, but they were a part of the group that later would be called the remnant. And God had allowed them to return from the captivity in Babylon of God's people and come back to his city of Jerusalem with the particular commission that they were to rebuild the city and to rebuild the temple that had been destroyed. God had set them free. And as his managers, as his stewards, now they were to rebuild Jerusalem and the temple. But like their ancient ancestors, these Jews of the remnant also at some point chose to disobey God. They chose to disobey the owner, the boss, and they became unfaithful stewards. They were still God's managers, for no person can abandon that role that God has given them. But they were no longer good stewards. They had become unfaithful managers. And so God sent a word through his prophet. God said, "Hear me." And we read it in Malachi chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. "Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me," he told them. "But you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation," said the Lord. Now, 2 weeks ago, we looked at the perks of being a manager. Today, I want us to look at the pitfalls. Now, I can tell you, I knew from the time I began to prepare this message that this would not be a popular message. I'm glad right now it's not on Facebook, so you don't have to hit like or dislike. I know where that would come out. But let me tell you something you may not know. I don't particularly like it either. it's not really the message I would like to preach. I'd much rather preach about the blessings than the curses. I'd much rather expound God's word about the perks of being a faithful manager than the pitfalls of being an unfaithful steward. But folks, the truth is, will you just think with me for a minute? The truth is, both of these are needed. And that is why we have both of them given to us in the Scripture. You know, the elevator arrives with the sweet sound of a bell and a pleasant little light that either points up or down. But the fire alarm is loud and it grates on the ears. You know, it drives you crazy to hear it. No one delights in it. Nobody ever goes and says, "Well, I think I'll push the button and set off the fire alarm. I just want to hear that melody one more time." Yet both are needed. And the truth is, we need the fire alarm much more than we need the elevator bell. The bell is a convenience. The alarm can save lives. And I should add that as your pastor, I am also not totally naive. Now, I know that some of you were already, some of you for many, many years, you're faithful managers in partnership with God, and you were before we ever even began to look at these principles. I hope that some of you, as we have looked at these principles that begin in Genesis but go throughout the Scripture and into the New Testament, I hope that some of you have begun in the last several weeks to start practicing good stewardship, start being the good managers that God has intended for you to be. But I certainly am not so naive to think that everybody has arrived at that point, even deciding that you'll begin the journey of becoming a faithful manager and partner of God. And I'm afraid that probably there are some of you, and you'll be glad to know I can't call your name. I have no idea who they are. I just am confident that in a congregation this size, that there are some of you that, though you have considered what the Word of God says, you've just decided, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to be what the Scripture calls a good manager. Others of you haven't made such a blatant decision, but you're just kind of hoping that eventually the preacher will get off of this and this topic will just go away and you won't make a decision. But the truth remains. Folks, every one of us, me as much as you, every one of us have been created by God as His manager. And we just are. And the only choice we can make is whether we're going to be a good manager or a bad one. We're either going to be a faithful steward or an unfaithful one. And this morning, really out of love for you, you know, out of a concern that all of us will know the joy of being what God has created us to be, I want to warn you. I want to share with you the warning of God's Word of the pitfalls of being an unfaithful manager. And the pitfalls come really in two groups. The first one is simply that an unfaithful manager robs God. Now, folks, you may be thinking, man, that is strong, strong language. And quite honestly, I wouldn't use it, except God did. I mean, this is God speaking. All Brother Mike's doing is repeating this. But God said through Malachi to these of the remnant who had come back, the ones who were part of God's chosen people, but now, though they were God's managers, they had just rejected doing what the boss had told them to do, to gather their resources together and use what God had put in their charge, and specifically to get the temple of God built again and the rebuilding of the city. And He said, "Will you rob me? Yet you have robbed me." How? By withholding tithes and offerings. So an unfaithful manager robs God. He robs God, first of all, of money that belongs to God. But let me tell you another robbery that we do when we are not faithful managers, when we're not good stewards. We rob God of delight. We rob God of the delight that He has in our obedience. In 1 Samuel 15:22, we read, "So Samuel said, 'Has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams.'" What God delights in, folks, is our obedience. Every time we obey the Lord, every time we just simply do what God tells us to do, we bring delight into the heart of God. Have you ever considered that you and what you do, that you can actually bring the Creator pleasure? That you can cause His face to smile, His heart to beat stronger in joy? And yet that is what the Scripture tells us. After all, remember, we are made in His image. Parents, how do you feel when your kids do what you've asked them to do? Isn't there a delight in the heart over that? Isn't there an inward joy in that? Why do we experience that? We experience that because we are made in the image of God. We are made like Him. And when His creatures, and most especially those who are His children through faith in Christ and are going to spend all eternity with Him, every time that we are obedient in the things of God, we bring delight to His heart. But likewise, when we are disobedient, when we will not do what God has told us not only He wants us to do, but has shown us is in our own best interest, and when we still disobey, we rob God of the delight that He could have had in our obedience. We rob God of funding for God's ministries through Christ Church. We rob God of His gospel going out into the world. And you may say, well, but Brother Mike, do you mean that God is dependent on us giving our tithes and offerings to the Lord to do His work in ministry? That God is dependent on us giving our tithes and offerings for the gospel to go out in the world? Listen, friend, God is dependent on that, but not because He needs our resources, but because it is God's chosen way of doing it. Because God, in both wisdom and in His love for us, has made us His partners. And in making us His partners, in choosing for us to manage what God has created, He has imposed a limitation on Himself. It's not that God couldn't do it another way. It's not that God couldn't take, for instance, our Center of Hope Ministries and, you know, drop a bag of gold on the doorstep of each one whatever morning He wanted to do so. God doesn't lack in gold. You know, God could do that. But He doesn't. He doesn't. He sends it through people. Why? Because God has chosen in love and wisdom to make us His partners. And so God sends His resources through His people. Paul explains, I call it the pipeline principle, that God gives to each of us sufficiently so that every good work can be funded. But the problem is that, folks, sometimes as God's pipelines, we get clogged up. You know, we need some Drano in our system. It's not that God's not sending the resources to flow. It's really that we're diverting it, that we're clogging it up. We're not letting it flow through us. And so when we will not be the good managers, when we will not be the faithful stewards, then we rob God's ministries of the funding support they need to operate. We rob the gospel from going out to all of the lost peoples of the world. But folks, when we are not a good manager, we not only rob God, listen, the unfaithful manager robs himself. We rob ourselves. Malachi said, listen, you have robbed God by withholding your tithes and offerings. And he says, you are cursed with a curse. Well, what is the curse? The curse is that in robbing God, you rob yourself. Well, how do you rob yourself when you withhold the tithes and the offerings? Well, first, we rob ourselves of peace of mind that comes with obedience. Now, most of you know exactly what I'm talking about, and this is not just applicable in concerning our stewardship or our giving. But when we obey the Lord, I mean, when we do things and we are habitually doing things, we're repeatedly doing things that we know this is what the Lord has said to do. And we're walking with the Lord, we're walking with obedience. There is a peace of mind. There is a settledness of heart that comes with that. Amen? But when we're not, when we have fallen into a pattern, I'm not talking about just a one-time stubbing our toe, but we start to walk in a pattern of a certain disobedience, a certain area of sin, what's the first thing that we lose? We lose that peace of mind. We lose that security of heart that we feel. So we rob ourselves. We rob ourselves of blessings that God wants to give. God says, if you'll just trust me enough to give the tithe and the offering, try it. I will open the windows of heaven and pour out blessings on you so great you'll not be able to receive them. And as I pointed out, not all of those blessings are financial. God's not just saying, well, you give the 10% and I'll just give you more and more money. Some of them will be financial. But there'll be blessings far beyond. Blessings that'll be far more important to you than financial blessings. Blessings that money could never buy, that come as a part of that. But when we don't do it, one of the pitfalls of being a manager who chooses to not be a faithful manager is that when we rob God, we also rob ourselves of those blessings that God really wanted to give. And we rob ourselves of the 10% that we didn't give to God. Now listen, this is really something. Think about this. We withhold, when we're an unfaithful steward, when we're not a good manager, we withhold the 10%. Why? Because we have another use for it. There's something else we want to do. Maybe it's we think that we just have to have that to meet our essential living expenses. Maybe there's something a little extra that we want it for. Maybe we want to put it back for retirement or for a rainy day just to be careful. But we have plans for it other than to give it back to God. But what the scripture is telling us, folks, we never get to use it for those purposes. It never works that way. Because when we're not good managers, when we're not faithful stewards, God does not rebuke the destroyer, the devourer. And the devourer comes and snatches up the 10%. And folks, let me tell you, he is greedy and he often gets more than the 10%. He'll often get into part of the other 90% that we would have retained, even not counting the blessings that God would have sent. And so we rob ourselves even of the use of the 10% that we withheld. We rob ourselves of the fulfillment of being a good partner with God. We rob ourselves of being a partner in the gospel. We rob ourselves of being a partner in the spreading of God's good news. Let me tell you one of the great regrets that I have. I mean, one of the things that if I had a time machine and I could go back a number of years, one of the things that I would do differently. And that is that it was not until I was 50 years old that I really let the truth of Acts 1:8 penetrate my heart, so that I began to have a heart for the world. I always was concerned about being a witness in my Jerusalem and a tiny little bit in my Judea, and very occasionally, maybe once every couple of years, somewhere in my Samaria. But I had never been a witness anywhere in all the ends of the earth, and not from lack of opportunity, just from a lack of a desire to obey God at that point. When God finally broke my heart in this, I made a commitment to Him to become an Acts 1:8 Christian. And after that, to become an Acts 1:8 pastor and to lead my church. And I was in Slidell at that time, but to lead my church to become an Acts 1:8 church, where we would be witnesses of Christ where we lived, and a little further away, and through our whole country, and then to the very ends of the earth. But I regret with all my soul that did not happen in my life until I was 50 years old. And that's why at my age, I plan to keep going until God will not allow me to have the strength, because I missed a lot of years. I appeal to you young people. I appeal to you young adults. And I remember the thinking of how many times I received an invitation just to go with a group and to preach in a crusade in a country where Christ was being shared. And I just said, you know, I'm just so busy. I can't raise the funds right now. I've got kids at home, and I've got a church that's busy, and I just can't go. Let me tell you, if you couldn't go, God wouldn't give us the command to go. And just getting older is not going to relieve all the busyness, will it, folks that are above 40, 45? Is that true? Is that an amen? No, yeah. You know, you get busy with different things. But the press, the time press, the sense that you don't have time to do it, that you can't do it, you can't raise the resources to do it, none of that changes. So go ahead and tackle it while you're in your 20s, while you're in your 30s. Tackle it while you're in your teens. I'm so glad we have a church that helps our teens go on mission. To go on mission here. They do missions right here in Jerusalem first. But then they go out, and they go out to Judea and Samaria, and we have they go to the ends of the earth. We have a number that have gone to Mexico. We got a group of seniors that are fixing to go to East Asia, and I'm so glad that we have a church that sees the importance and helps these teenagers. But I'm glad you're willing to go. It's important for you to learn to go when you're young. But let's all of us don't wait. Don't wait until you're an old man or an old woman to learn this lesson and miss out on those years. That's the one part of my stewardship for the Lord, of my managing what God entrusted to me, that I regret with all my heart, because I missed out. I robbed myself of the fulfillment of being a partner with God in the gospel in these other areas for so many years. We rob ourselves of fulfillment in ministry, fulfillment in just managing our finances, and of increased faith. Listen, folks, when you choose to be a manager with God, God will let you be in places where it takes real faith to give that gift to the Lord. Where you just think, this month, this week, I cannot turn loose of this tithe. There's already too much month at the end of the money, and I cannot do it. And then out of obedience, you just let it go. And you say, God, I'm just going to trust you. I have no idea how we're going to make it this week, but I trust you. And then you see God come through. You see God bless. You see God open the windows of heaven and do things that you've never seen God do before. But if you don't do it, you never get to see it. And you've robbed yourself of the increased faith that would have come by just trusting God. My dear friend, I hope you understand. I share these warnings with you just because I love you, because I care for you. I want God's best for you, and God sends this warning. You know, these are not warnings that originate with Brother Mike. They're not warnings that originate with Baptists. They're not warnings that originate with the church. This is the Word of God. You know, I've shown it to you. We have read it. You have seen it. But even God sends this word of warning to us because He loves us. God wants the very best for all of us. You know, Ezekiel tells us, God takes no pleasure when people reap the consequences of their sin. God is no sadist that he sits on his throne in heaven delighting for someone to break one of the rules so he can squash them. That's not God. God wants for you, God wants for me to be engaged in this partnership that He created for us for, to be a good manager. For being God's good manager is not burdensome. It's joyful. Let me just close by asking, are you already one of God's faithful managers? One of God's good stewards? Then bless you. Only I don't even need to say that because God is already blessing you. Just continue for God's glory and your own good. For those that cannot answer yes, let me ask you, will you just decide to become one of God's faithful managers and engage in partnership with Him? I told you, you know, for 50 years of my life, 42 of those years I was a Christian because I got saved when I was 8. But for all those years, I was not a faithful manager of the gospel because I didn't take it everywhere I had an opportunity. But one day, I decided to obey. And I can tell you, that's what makes me regret I didn't do it sooner. Because what a joy, what a thrill, what a delight. And I found that obeying God in this is not a burden. It's not a command that I say, oh my goodness, I got to go do this thing again because God's making me do it. No, I delight to go wherever, whether it's here in Jerusalem or Judea or Samaria, the end of the earth, I delight to go. It is filled with joy and with satisfaction and with wonder. May the scripture that Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 4:1, I shared it with you weeks ago, but let me just remind you, may it be true of all of us. Let a man so consider us as servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Stand with me. Let's pray.